The Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom and gently lead those that are with young. Good morning. It's my privilege to welcome you wherever you are today to this service of worship from West Worthing Evangelical Church. In the Bible verses I read just now, we are brought face to face with two glorious truths about God: his almighty power and his tender care of everyone who acknowledges and commits themselves to him. Our opening hymn blends those two aspects as it reminds us of God's greatness and glory, but also that at his side is the man of love, the crucified. And it is because of that man, the Lord Jesus Christ, God's Son, who died for our sins, that fallible, human, sinful beings like us, like you and me, can come into the presence of this wonderful God. So let's join in singing this lovely song, "The Lord is King, lift up your voice." Now let us pray. O Lord, you are God and there is no other. You are the God who called all things into existence and who keeps the whole universe going. We realize that we are totally dependent upon you in every area of our lives, and we marvel at the fact of your care for us. For you are not only the Almighty God, but the God who cannot look upon sin with approval, nor overlook it wherever it may be found. When we're honest with ourselves, we know that we're not what we should be. We confess that very often we don't even come up to our own standards, let alone the purity that a holy God requires. So how can we come before you and find a welcome? We bless you that it's not because of what we have done, but because of the man of love, the crucified, who bore our sins and took our punishment on the cross at Calvary. Thank you for your grace and mercy that sent Jesus to lead us into your loving arms. So we gladly acknowledge your claim upon our lives and love and worship this morning. please cleanse us from all our failure. Grant us your spirit to serve you better and to worship you now. We ask it in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Our first reading this morning comes from God's Word in the book of Daniel in the Old Testament and chapter 1, the first chapter of the book of Daniel. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand with some of the vessels of the house of God. And he brought them to the land of Shinar, to the house of his God, and placed the vessels in the treasury of his God. Then the king commanded Ashpenaz, his chief eunuch, to bring some of the people of Israel, both of the royal family and of the nobility, youths without blemish, of good appearance, and skillful in all wisdom, endowed with knowledge, understanding, learning, and competent to stand in the king's palace, and to teach them the literature and language of the Chaldeans. The king assigned them a daily portion of the food that the king ate and of the wine that he drank. They were to be educated for 3 years, and at the end of that time they were to stand before the king. Among these were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah of the tribe of Judah. And the chief of the eunuchs gave them names. Daniel he called Belteshazzar. Hananiah he called Shadrach. Mishael he called Meshach. And Azariah he called Abednego. But Daniel resolved that he would not defile himself with the king's food or with the wine that he drank. Therefore he asked the chief of the eunuchs to allow him not to defile himself. And God gave Daniel favor and compassion in the sight of the chief of the eunuchs. And the chief of the eunuchs said to Daniel, "I fear my lord the king, who assigned your food and your drink. For why should he see that you were in worse condition than the youths who are of your own age? So you would endanger my head and with the king." Then Daniel said to the steward, whom the chief of the eunuchs had assigned over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, "Test your servants for 10 days. Let us be given vegetables to eat and water to drink. Then let our appearance and the appearance of the youths who eat the king's food be observed by you, and deal with your servants according to what you see." So he listened to them in this matter and tested them for 10 days. At the end of 10 days, it was seen that they were better in appearance and fatter in flesh than all the youths who ate the king's food. So the steward took away their food and the wine they were to drink and gave them vegetables. As for these 4 youths, God gave them learning and skill in all literature and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. At the end of the time, when the king had commanded that they should be brought in, the chief of the eunuchs brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar. And the king spoke with them, and among all of them, none was found like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore they stood before the king, and in every matter of wisdom and understanding about which the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and enchanters that were in all his kingdom. And Daniel was there until the first year of King Cyrus. The next song that we're going to sing is called O Father, You Are Sovereign, and it celebrates the authority and power of God. Now let us come before the Lord again in prayer. Our gracious God, we thank you that you are sovereign, that this world and all that is in it is in your wise care and control. And we want to pray for this world, which is troubled by so many problems at the moment. We think of the continuing threat and problem of COVID-19. And we ask in your mercy that this will soon be brought under control and brought to an end. We thank you for the untiring work of all those who are caring for the sick, all those who are striving to improve on the resources that there are to combat it. And we pray you will sustain and refresh them. We bring before you those who mourn, who have lost loved ones during this dreadful time. And we pray that you will comfort them and draw them to yourself. For those whose lives have been shattered in one way or another because of the effects of this pandemic, those who are still experiencing distress because they've had COVID and it lingers and works still in their bodies and in their systems, Lord, bring them relief, we pray. We thank you for the vaccines which are available and for others which will be coming onto the market soon. And we ask, Lord, that they may be really effective, that they may be rolled out quickly and efficiently, that people may have access to them easily. And Lord, we pray for those countries across the world which are not so rich as some in the West, some of those countries where they are struggling to get supplies of the vaccine. We ask, Lord, that there may be fair distribution and that those people would not be neglected in their needs. We pray too because of the other problems that besiege our world. There are people suffering across the world from natural disasters. We think of the dreadful havoc that can be wrought by the weather with storm or drought, and we pray for any who are affected by such things. We think of the inhumanity that is practiced in some areas of the world against their fellow human beings. We think of those who are being persecuted for their faith. And we ask, Father, that you will overrule and iron out and prevent these injustices. We pray that you will give wisdom to world leaders, that you will enable them to pursue peace and righteousness. And we would bring before you the new president of the United States and the new administration. And we pray that you will bless and guide and use that, and that they may be able to heal the divisions in that land. That we pray that these early days might be marked out by peace and calm rather than conflict and hatred. But then, Lord, we would pray for the greatest need of all men and women, that the good news of Jesus Christ might be spread, that they may come into contact with it, that through that good message, that wonderful message of the love of God shown to us in Christ, they may find true peace and fulfillment in reconciliation to you, the God who made us and the God who reaches out to us in Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Our second reading this morning comes from Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 2 and verses 12 to 17. And in this letter to Christians living in a society which is hostile to Christianity, Paul reminds them of the selflessness of the Lord Jesus that marked his life. And he urges them to cultivate the same spirit. And then he tells them to take that attitude into their everyday life so that their unbelieving society may see the reality and the goodness of the Christian message. So we read from Philippians 2 and verse 12. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Do all things without grumbling or disputing, that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God without blemish in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast to the word of life, so that in the day of Christ I may be proud that I did not run in vain or labor in vain. Even if I am to be poured out as a drink offering upon the sacrificial offering of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with you all. Likewise, you also should be glad and rejoice with me. Now we seek that God should come to us, touch our hearts and touch our lives in our next song. Breathe on us, breath of God. Those Second War documentaries that sometimes are shown on our televisions, you may recall, because quite often it is shown, those scenes of, which I find quite haunting, of the platforms of our railway stations, the city's railway stations, packed with children of all ages. There they are, gas masks over their shoulders, small case in their hand, a piece of paper pinned to their coat with their name written on it. There they are with their mothers, those last few minutes before they are taken away to a destination they've never been before, that they know nothing about. It's a deeply traumatic moment. They don't know when they'll be coming back, when they'll be coming back, if they'll be coming back. They don't know what awaits them, where they're going. It is true that some of the children have very good experiences, but it's equally true that many of the children had the exact opposite. It's a heartbreaking picture as you see these children being sent away for a good reason, to try and save them from the bombing that was about to be unleashed on the cities, but it was heartbreaking. Now, if you've got that memory in your mind, hang on to it, while we fast rewind to the 6th century before Jesus Christ. And we meet these four young teenagers, probably about 14 years of age, that we meet in Daniel 1. Here are these boys being forcibly relocated from their own country into a hostile country elsewhere, whose army has recently overcome their own military. But this, of course, happened in 605 BC. So why bother about it today? Indeed, why bother with the book of Daniel? After all, what's it about? It divides into two parts. There's chapters 1 to 6, which are narrative, and often people have some idea of these chapters because it's full of adventure stories, which is just the right kind of fuel for Sunday school lessons. But then chapters 7 to 12 is full of prophecy and picturesque language, which sadly has often given rise to plenty of fanciful interpretations. So why bother with this book? Why bother with this chapter, this incident? Well, this chapter that we've read this morning highlights three great themes which are always relevant. And the first of those is God's sovereignty. God's sovereignty, what does that mean? God's sovereignty means that God is in control anywhere. God is in control everywhere. God is in control always. And God is in control here in the events of Daniel chapter 1. Do you raise an eyebrow at that thought? After all, what a mess we are confronted with in this chapter. The kingdom of Judah is going through a really, really bad time. King Josiah has died, and one of his sons, Jehoahaz, by public acclaim, has been put on the throne. He's there for 3 months and does nothing good while he's there. And then the Pharaoh from Egypt comes with his forces and removes him, takes him away, and installs his older brother Jehoiakim as a vassal king. And then the new bully on the block, Nebuchadnezzar, with the Babylonian forces, sweeps down and defeats Egypt at the Battle of Carchemish, sweeps on to subjugate all in his path. And King Jehoiakim of Judah knuckles under to Nebuchadnezzar for 3 years. But then he makes a miscalculation and rebels against Nebuchadnezzar, and retribution falls. And there it is in verse 1. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And if you go into 2 Chronicles and chapter 36, you have this more light on the story. Jehoiakim was 25 years old when he began to reign. He reigned 11 years in Jerusalem. He did what was evil in the sight of the Lord his God. Against him came up Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and bound him in chains to take him to Babylon. Nebuchadnezzar also carried part of the vessels of the house of the Lord to Babylon and put them in his palace in Babylon. Yes, here's the situation, you see. Invasion, defeat, captivity, the stripping of the vessels from the house of God, and the deportation of young and gifted men to Babylon. But wait a minute. Israel, which comprised the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom of Judah, they are God's people. Israel is God's people, aren't they? They're in a covenant relationship with him, aren't they? They're the people to whom the promises belong and whose land God has promised to protect. Isn't that so? Well, the northern kingdom was already finished when over 100 years before they had been transported by the Assyrians invaders. But now here in Judah, this southern kingdom, the temple is desecrated. The vessels which were holy and which were for the glory of God taken from the temple and dedicated to Nebuchadnezzar's God back in Babylon, surely showing that God's supremacy over the God of Judah. What a total mess. So who's in the driving seat? Where is God's sovereignty in this disastrous situation? But do you notice there are three very significant words in verse 2? We're told in verse 1 that Nebuchadnezzar came to Jerusalem, besieged it, but verse 2 says, and the Lord gave Jehoiakim into his hand. The Lord gave. That's very significant. It is true, of course, that God did make promises of great blessing to his people. But he also promised judgment if they rejected him. And that's what they've been doing down through the years, in rain after rain. And now the temple had become merely a talisman, a kind of lucky charm, if you like. Well, that's there, we're all right. God's with us, yes. But eventually the long-lasting patience of God came to an end. So actually, you see, in these events, the macho Babylonian king, who's throwing his weight about and trying to tell everybody who's boss, ends up being a mere errand boy for God, carrying out God's purpose. So despite all the appearance of the situation, God is in charge. Now, that brings comfort and it brings challenge. How we need that comfort in our own times. We live in confusing times. The days are dark and threatening. Sometimes we are full of foreboding. What is happening? Where are we going? Where are we all going to end up? We feel vulnerable. What will happen? And sometimes life seems like a giant juggernaut, driverless and out of control. But no. A sovereign God is in control. He is working out his purposes, even when the rulers and the nations foul up completely. When you and I foul up totally, there is a God who cares for all he has made. And we find ourselves perhaps in situations we can't comprehend. And yet, because God is sovereign, there is purpose, there is hope. With Judah, for example, dreadful as these events were, they were intended to bring them to their senses. It was intended to be remedial, to bring them to repentance and faith and to seek God again. And it did happen, but it took a long time, 70 years. C.S. Lewis, in probably one of his best-known quotes, had this to say about pain. He said, pain insists upon being attended to. God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks in our conscience, but shouts in our pains. It is his megaphone to rouse a deaf world. God works in the dark days as well as in the sunlight. And his sovereignty is not that of a tyrant, but of a gracious and a holy God. So there is comfort. But there's also a challenge, and the challenge is clear too. It is a challenge to our world, to our society. It is a challenge to any of us who refuse to listen to him, who see no need of him now and in eternity, who have no time for the forgiveness and the love that he offers through Jesus Christ. And that challenge is simply this. The offer has a cut-off date. And when God calls time, it will be too late to change our minds. God's sovereignty is here. But also, we can see God's servants. What about these four lads? Why were they deported? Well, Nebuchadnezzar had a great game plan in mind. His idea was, look, let's cream off some of the elite youth from Judah. Those who come from good homes, those who are presentable, those who are educated, those who are clever, those who are competent. Let's ship them off to Babylon, give them a first-class Babylonian education, and then we'll slip them into my super-duper civil service. And that would not only benefit the king and the state, but would be a satisfying career move for these young men as well, even if they'd had it forced upon them. But there were subtle dangers for these young men from that. Here were four young men who had a faith in the one true God. But everything in the program that Nebuchadnezzar instituted was calculated to re-educate not only their mindset, but their soul set. Even the very names, which seems innocuous at first perhaps, but even the names were calculated to work along that line. Daniel means God is my judge, but he's renamed Belteshazzar, which means may Bel or Marduk protect you. Hananiah means Yahweh is gracious, but he's renamed Shadrach, which means the command of Aku, who was the moon god. Mishael, who is what God is, becomes Meshach, who is what Aku is. Azariah, what Yahweh has helped, becomes Abednego, servant of Nebo, the god of wisdom. The whole idea was to separate them from their past, to divorce them from that, to assimilate them into this new culture, this new way of thinking. And at every turn, there were subtle pressures to become part of the prevailing and popular culture. In verse 4, we are told that Nebuchadnezzar's plan was to give these young fellows a good education and to teach them the literature and the language of the Chaldeans. And one commentator says, what might that include? And he comes up with a formidable list. What might be the immersion in the literature and language of the Chaldeans? What might it involve? Probably the study of Sumerian, Akkadian, and Aramaic among languages and extensive literature written in them, including the various mythological texts as well as historiography, astronomy, mathematics, and medicine. They'd likely have to imbibe the scientific omen texts. For example, there was a series of astrological omens in 77 tablets, 23 of which focused on observations of the moon. Then perhaps medical omens, one series ran to 40 tablets, nor could they neglect dream interpretation, the longest collection runs to 110 tablets. The regimen could probably prove overwhelming. After a bit, one likely felt a wash in Babylonian literature and law. It would be very easy to get swamped by that culture, by that teaching. But don't forget, these four men are in Babylon because of God's sovereignty. That's why they're there. You know, there's a lesson for us here. There is this continual pressure and threat for God's people in every age to lose our distinctiveness. The pressures are on to cause us to tell us, fall into line with society. Listen to what society has to say about life, about morals, about behaviour, about faith, and conform with that. And God's people are in it, in that world. Now that's not a mistake on God's part. This is the world he's put us into to be his servants, to be his representatives. It's a dangerous world that we live in. It's subtle, invasive, it can encroach. It can affect us without realising the inroads it's making. So how do we face this? How do we make sure that we don't lose our edge, that we don't lose our distinctiveness? Well, look at Daniel. In verse 8 we're told, Daniel resolved he would not defile himself with the king's food or with the wine that he drank. That was part of the perks, you see, of being in this king's re-educational scheme. Food from the king's table, wine from the king's table came to these people. Because the king wanted premium specimens. Well, now, of course, Daniel can't just pop down to the local McDonald's and order up a burger. So he has to go to the chief of staff, and he goes there and he asks to be allowed to eat vegetables. Now, Daniel, at doing that, was actually taking a risk. It was a dangerous situation Verse 10 makes that quite clear. The chief of the eunuch says to Daniel, I fear my lord the king who assigned you food and drink, because if you look worse than the others, and he finds out why, you'd endanger my head. So it's a dodgy situation. And when Daniel went to him, that chief of staff could very easily have reacted angrily and aggressively against Daniel, or reported him to the king. But you notice, verse 9, that is significant words again. God gave Daniel favor and compassion in the sight of the chief of the eunuchs, and God gave. You see, God's sovereignty is here in this situation. He's in control. So Daniel goes from the chief of staff down to the steward, who has immediate responsibility for them, and asks him, suggests a trial to him. And you notice Daniel's approach when he comes up against the system. Do you notice how he registers that difference, how he comes and makes his case? He's clear, he's definite, he's persistent, but he's polite and reasonable. And that's important. When we face the issues, when we have to take stands against things, do these aspects mark out the way we do it? It's one thing if people are antagonized by the message. It's quite another if they're antagonized by the messenger. But why did Daniel go down this path in the first place? Why did he refuse these provisions? And you can look in the books, and there are lots of different views which have been advanced. One is that he wanted to refuse it because you never know, there might have been something unclean, ceremonially unclean, that is, as far as Jews were concerned, coming through on the food. But that argument wouldn't apply to the wine, would it? So that doesn't seem really to hold much water. Others have suggested that before the food was served up, it would have been dedicated to an idol, one of their gods, one of the Babylonian gods. But in that case, so would the vegetables. So is that really the answer? Others think perhaps it's a symbolic gesture. To take his food would indicate dependence on the king. But where did the vegetables come from anyway? They were also would have come from the king's table. So the best view, it seems to me, is that they were actually doing this in order to remind themselves that they were different to Babylon. It was a daily exercise in pulling themselves up short and saying, we're not Babylonians, we're Jews, we're God's people, he's our Lord. And they were doing it, exercising this choice to resist assimilation. A small thing really, isn't it? Deciding you're not going to eat something and then, but you'll eat something else. Small thing, but it really important. But you know, if Daniel and his friends had not stood on the small things, would they have stood when the big test came? I guess we can all envisage things in our life where if we were asked to do certain things, if something that outraged us as far as our Christian faith was concerned, we say, I'd never do that. But how do you prepare for such a stand? Faithfulness in small things, small matters, prepares us for faithfulness in larger. And conversely, when we make small accommodations, that can rot our resolve and cause collapse when the pressures really are on. So the principle holds true for believers in any age. It holds true for us that we belong to a different sovereign. We belong to a different kingdom. It's so easy to get sucked in by the society and the standards around us. And we need to constantly remind ourselves to whom we belong, to check ourselves against God's word, to check ourselves against the Lord Jesus Christ. God's sovereignty, God's servants, and finally, God's strategy. Uni was finished. The education was over, and there was the final oral exam by the king, and what do you know? They come out top of the class, Daniel and his three friends. They're voted the boys most likely to. But look again at verse 17, will you? Look at verse 17. As for these four youths, God gave them learning and skill in all literature and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. Now that doesn't, when it says God gave them this, it doesn't mean that he did all the work. They had to study, and they did. They worked hard at their studies, but God strengthened them, God surrounded them, and blessed their efforts. And what's happened now? Nebuchadnezzar has made every effort to eradicate any knowledge of God from them and to substitute his own God. But now, God has four servants of his at the heart of a pagan empire and able to have an impact for him. And look at verse 21. Don't overlook that. That's not just a footnote. Daniel was there until the first year of King Cyrus. By then, Nebuchadnezzar was dead and gone. Babylon had been defeated. There was a new king, Cyrus. There was a new kingdom, Persia. Daniel is in his 80s, but he's still there. The witness is still there. Now, it's always God's strategy for his people. He doesn't take them out of this world. He sends them into the world to make a difference. You remember the words of the Lord Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount? In verses, in chapter 5 and verses 13 to 16, he said, "You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." Jesus says his people are to be salt, to preserve against the inroads of sin and evil, to bring taste into life, to create thirst in people for him, and light that cuts through the darkness and shows things for what they are, shows the truth and shows the way. And when you read the book of Daniel, you will find that there is evidence that Nebuchadnezzar and Darius were influenced by the witness of Daniel. Now, don't misunderstand me. Not many get to serve in the corridors of power. Most of us are unremarked by our world and unknown. But wherever God places us, we are there to be his representatives in our attitudes, our words, our standards, our behaviour in every area of our lives. Because this is his strategy to bring our world, our contemporaries, our colleagues, our neighbours, our friends, our families into contact with this sovereign God, who alone can bring new life, forgiveness, and a bright new future to us through trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to sing our last song, a lovely song, "Come, People of the Risen King." King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. And may grace, mercy, and peace be with us and all God's people now and forevermore. Amen.
Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us?